Hey, I haven't been here in ages. It is so good to see you all. My name is Jason, as I was about to say Pastor Tanya just said. Just let's do it, Pastor Tanya. As Tan just shared, I'm part of the team here at Encompass, and some of you are looking at me going, where have you been? Like, as in, what's wrong with you? Is everything okay? I bumped into Auntie Emily and Jack in the car park at the start of the week. And this is what she said to me. She goes, I've been praying for you. And I thought to myself, she's thought I've backslidden. Like, I thought that was so funny. We had a good laugh about it. It was really funny. Sorry to throw you under a bus there. But listen, if you're wanting to know where I've been actually in Craigieburn campus helping the team launch there. Pastor Colin and Teresa are doing an exceptional job. Honestly, they're doing an incredible job. We have a great team out there. Yesterday, we had a huge Easter event out in the community there. And it was like 10 o'clock, and it was like a bit slow. And then out of nowhere, hundreds and hundreds of families came through this Craigieburn location. It was so amazing to see. And so, you know, this is the thing, right? The only reason that we could set up and send such an incredible church in Craigieburn is because of the foundations here in Bundoora. Did you know that? And so, listen, I just want to say to you, like, as in, thank you so much for what you've already been doing throughout these years. And it's because of the strength here that we're able to do such amazing things in different locations. Can I get an amen? Are you guys excited about that? And so here's the thing. I know you miss Mark and Jana in Doreen. So do I. Like, as in, and I know you maybe miss, Bill and Dee or Colin and Teresa. And you go, man, I miss my church family. You miss Alyssa and the other guy. Like, as in, you know, you miss all these people. And it's nice because you're supposed to miss them because we're family. Everyone say we're family. But we're also an army. And armies take ground. Okay, and so when you're an army, it's all good. But so when you're a family, it's all good. But when you're an army, we've got to keep moving. You know what I mean? And so I would encourage you to get used to the idea of sending and setting up great churches around our communities. Can I get an amen? Amen. Don't want to reiterate it, but I will. This Friday is Good Friday. It's a 9 a.m. service. As Pastor John said a few weeks ago, hey, let's make it a priority. If you're watching online, let's get back to church. Come on, let's come back. Join us. All our locations will be here at 9 a.m. And then obviously on Sunday morning, all our locations will run in their relevant areas. So that's kind of the update, right? Like, as in, we've launched a campus, been away for 6 weeks, and we had a bebe. We had the bebe. This is Amara Day, and that's Harley there. She's very cute. She's 4 weeks old. We love her dearly. It's been great to kind of just, you know, have a new person part of the family. Do you know what I mean? Like, you're kind of getting to know them and going, oh my goodness, how cute. And so I've got public settings. I've got to be careful what I say. But listen, Harley is an epic big sister. She's right here on the front row. Well done, Harley. Alyssa is doing exceptionally well. How does Harley get a clap? And Alyssa, my wife, is doing amazingly well. And so we'll be around over the next few weeks. So it'll be great. But listen, we're so grateful to God and how much He's blessed our family and what He's doing in our lives. Shall we pray? Good idea? You guys at the back, shall we pray? You all right? Yeah, good. I got a thumbs up from someone. I'm like, I'm done. Monica Praveen, let's do this. All right. Heavenly Father, we just ask, Lord, that you will move this morning. So God, Lord, whatever we have brought in, we just pray, Lord, that we hear your word and we just we have an accepting and receptive heart this morning. That we, as we hear your word, there will be a revelation and there will be a sense of change in us and transformation in the mighty name of Jesus. And everyone said,
Amen.
As I said, we just had a baby and her name is Amara Day. Everyone say Amara Day. And when you tell people about your babies and their names, do you know what they do? Well, because the thing is that when I tell people, like, they always ask, hey, what does it mean? And then we say to them, hey, Amara means to be loved, okay? And then we say, but day is kind of like going, we just believe that this is the day that the Lord has made. And we also kind of have this thing of just going, hey, we just believe over the last couple of years, it's like she represents the dawning of a new day. Like, kind of like going, we want something different to take place, a blessing. And so they hear this conversation, and maybe I've never had a conversation here with anyone about this, but then someone, when you talk to them, they say, oh, but do you know what it means in my culture and in my language? And in my head, I go, I don't care. Hey, if you guys have all become serious for the last 6 weeks, I'll tell you, right, this is not going to work. But let me tell you, I'm just like, This is what I believe it means. You can say whatever you want, but as in, this is what it means to me. And they go, no, but it means beautiful, it means precious, it means godly one. I go, no. My friend, I love you. But this is what it means to me. You know, Harley means protector of people. And my belief, Alyssa's belief in this name is that Harley will use her strength because she's very strong. Oh my goodness, she's very strong. She's killing me. But she will use her strength to protect others. This is what I believe. Do you know what my name means, Jason? My name means healer. How do I know that? Two reasons, Google and my mum told me. But my name means, and here's the thing, right? Since I was young, my mum is Indian, like never before. So she will drill this into me. Your name means healer. You've got to understand, this is what it does. When I'm praying, there is a sense, there's an expectation that I'm believing the person I'm praying with is going to be healed. Not because I'm a healer, but because I believe that Jesus is going to use me at that point in time. And that God is going to use me and his power is going to work and going to move and people will be healed. Here's the thing though, this is what I've realized. And maybe your name means something special. Maybe your name means kind of like going whatever. But here's what I've come to realize is this. A name is just a name until it has some belief attached to it. A name is just a name until it has a little bit of belief attached to it. So your name might mean strong. Your name might be like, man, I am bold and I am strong. But you may live out a completely different name. Your name might mean beautiful, but maybe you feel the exact opposite of that. You don't carry yourself in that way because there's no belief attached to it. Maybe your name might mean peace, but your thoughts and your life, it's just kind of directed in all different directions. And as Tanya alluded to, as we kick off this series, names, this isn't about my name, but these are the names of Jesus. These are the names. And this is our prayer, is that we have a revelation in this series of who he is, his character and his power, his heart and his sovereignty, his identity and his ways. So over the next few weeks, I hope that we discover in Good Friday, Pastor John's going to be preaching into a name, and we're going to see the significance and the weight that the names of Jesus carry. Are you ready for today's scripture and name? Thank you to 7 people here. Is everyone else here ready for the scripture and name today? Come on, let's put it on the screen. Revelation chapter 1, verses 7 to 8, or this is verse 8. It says, look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all the people on earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. Verse 8. I am the Alpha and Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come. Revelation chapter 21, verse 6, it says, he said to me, it is done. Everyone say, it is done. It is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without a cost from the spring of the water of life. One more passage of scripture in Revelation. These are the words of Jesus right now. Revelation 22, verse 13. I am the Alpha and Omega. Everyone say the first and last. The beginning and the end. It is no secret today. We are going to be exploring the name Alpha and Omega. Everyone say Alpha and Omega. Alpha and Omega are the first and last letters of the Greek alphabet. Yasu, yasu, to all our Greek friends here. But it is the equivalent in English of saying from A to Z. It is an ancient saying to kind of go, hey, all in between, from here to there, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. It is the totality between these two phrases, Alpha and Omega. But to take this a little bit further, it says the two terms Alpha and Omega represent creation and eschatology. Let me show you this for a moment. The God who brought the world into existence, creation, is the same God who will bring it into completion, eschatology. So the name emphasizes the unique and total sovereignty. Everyone say sovereignty. The unique and total sovereignty of God. It's mentioned 3 times in Revelation, and then it goes into the Old Testament. Let's just quickly go here for a moment. Isaiah 41, verse 4, it says, I am the Lord, with the first of them and with the last of them, I am he. Isaiah 44, verse 6, it says, this is what the Lord says, Israel's King and Redeemer, Lord Almighty. I am the first and the last. Everyone say first and last. First and last. Apart from me, there is no God. There is no one above you, no one beside you, nobody like you. There will be no one, no other God before you. No one, no one. That's why we sing that song. I don't know if that was a good rendition or not, but that's what I'm saying. But I'll tell you, this: when you're singing this song, this is scripture. There is no one like him. There is no one before him. There is no one like him. There is no one like Jesus. He is the Alpha and Omega. Can we focus on Alpha for a moment? To call Jesus Alpha is to say that he is the beginning of everything. It's to acknowledge that everything starts. Everyone say starts. Say it like an Aussie. Starts. That's good. Change it up. Anyway, everything starts with him. This is what it says in John chapter 1, verse 3. It says, through him all things were made. With him nothing else was made that has been made. Bit of a confusing kind of thing. Through him all things were made. Unless it's made, it's been made by him. Listen, here's the thing. If you had a tag on yourself, it wouldn't say made in India, even though lots of things are made in India. It wouldn't say made in Australia with a gold and green kangaroo on it with a triangle sticker. It would say made by God. If the universe had a tag on it, you know what it would say? It would say made by God. That's what it said. Colossians 1 verse 16 to 17. I love this passage of scripture. This is what it says. It says, for in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. Verse 17, he is before all things, Alpha, and in him all things hold together. All things, not just some things, not just the big things, not just the things that make sense to you, not just the church stuff. All things he holds together. All things come from him. He is before all things. He is the start. He is the beginning. He is our first. You know, where you start is so important. Because when you don't start in the right place, things can go horribly wrong. When you don't start with Jesus as your Alpha, things can go a little bit crazy. It's like where you start when making formula. We're recently making formula, and you should see how quickly my wife and maternal health nurse told me off when they found out how I was making this formula. I was putting the powder in first, then the water, and then shake. That's not what you do. No. I got a speech for like 35 minutes. I was like going, take a chill pill. But you can do a lot of damage when you're not starting in the right place. It's like a recipe, right? When you're starting to cook something, if you start at the end or at the midpoint, that meal ain't going to work out very well. Where you start is so important. For example, any runners in the room, like anyone like run a marathon recently? I know Mabel has. She kind of told everyone about it a couple of weeks ago. But the thing is, when you run, where you start is so important, right? Because if I'm a marathon runner, I'm kind of running away. The fact is, if I don't start where I'm supposed to start, let's be honest here, right? I'm not running that race. I'm just running for fun. If I join them right at the end, I am running practically for no purpose whatsoever. I wonder how many people are out there that don't have Jesus as their start, and they are running this race in the world without any purpose. When you don't have Jesus as your starting point, let me tell you something, things don't make sense. It is important to know your start. When Jesus is your Alpha, you are saying everything begins with him. Everything begins with him. You approach things differently, right? You approach your relationships differently. You approach your careers differently. You approach those opportunities and decisions differently. You see things differently. You don't kind of go, I'm just kind of doing my own thing. But when you start with Jesus, you're going, Jesus, what do you want me to do for this season? Jesus, how do you want me to see? You start to see a bigger picture about what you're a part of. You don't just kind of see the little things that you're doing, but you're seeing everything and the God heart behind it. Most of us, though, we don't start our lives with Jesus as Alpha. We start our lives with me as our Alpha. I am Alpha. So, for example, let's pretend you kind of have a career taking place right now and a great opportunity comes about, maybe overseas or interstate. It's not like you start singing, "You were Alpha, Lord God. What do you want me to do with this decision today?" Like, as in, do you want me to go here or not? Like, as in, like, you're not kind of embracing him. You're not going, "God, I just want your heart. And although this opportunity is amazing, I'm putting you first." You know what I mean? Like, as in, you are my Alpha. You are my beginning. You're my starting point. We don't really go about life singing "You are Alpha" and asking him his thoughts on things. Most of the time, do you know what song we sing? Some of you may know it. Some of you may not. It's by a guy named John Bon Jovi. And it's "My Life." And it's "Now or Never." Vince has asked me to sing it. But the way that first song went, I don't think I am. I'm getting smart. I'm singing it. No. But it's "My It's Now." I ain't going to live forever. This is how we do it. We say, "I am the start. I am the Alpha of my life. I am the beginning." And we sing this song and we don't take into consideration God's voice. His Alpha voice in our lives. We're singing, "It starts with me. It's my life. It's my decision." To the person that starts with themselves as Alpha, you will never find your true self. The only interpretation of yourself that you have is yourself. But when you bring God into it, when you make Jesus your Alpha, you are bringing him into the picture. You're bringing him into the focus, into the frame, and saying, "Jesus, I start with you. You are Alpha. You are my purpose and you are my creator." When you put God first, when you make Jesus your Alpha, you live out a life that is according to his purpose. He is Alpha and Omega. To say Jesus is Alpha is to say that he is the beginning. It is to say that nothing is before him. It's to believe that he is uncreated. He is beginning less. To say Jesus and to see Jesus as Alpha is to not just see him as a good teacher, not just to see him as a healer, not just to see him as a savior, but it's to see him as God Almighty. It's to see him as God Almighty. But he has to become our start. It's about saying, "God, with my family, I start with you. With my second child, I'm starting with you. Maybe with my first child, I didn't really do things that well, but with this child, I'm starting with you. You are the beginning of everything." With that conversation, with that family member, with your career, it's to say, "Jesus, you are my Alpha. Everything starts with you. You are my beginning. You are my first. It all begins with you." Make him the starting point. The first of everything. Make him your answer. He is the creator of all things, and everything has its beginning in him. Alpha. Everything starts with him. Omega, not rocket science, but everything ends with him. Everything ends with him. So Alpha is everything starts with him. Now Omega is everything ends with him. This is what it means to us personally. It means everything ends with him. He is my aim and all that I need. Everyone say that right now. He is my aim and all that I need. He is my aim and all that I need. I'll tell you a time when Alyssa, my wife, dramatically offended me. We were dating during this time and we were both in ministry. We weren't even fighting, okay? This was just a nice, good conversation. So my wife, who knows my wife here? Like, some of you know my wife. Very, very clean cut. Like, as in, you never guess what she's thinking. She will tell you, and she is very precise with her words. Anyway, the early stages of dating, I was puppy in love. Like, I was like a pup. Like, I was like, "Whatever you want, babe." Like, as in, like, you know, I was kind of like, "Babe, you can say whatever you want. I'm in love with you. I'll do whatever you want." You know what I mean? Anyway, we're having this conversation about God and about ministry and all this stuff. We weren't even fighting in tet. Like, this is honestly, this is true. We weren't fighting. And do you know what she said to me? She goes, "Jace, I'd be okay. I wouldn't be heartbroken if we broke up." I'm offended, stage one. But that wasn't even just it. There was more to this. She goes, "No, because I love God more than I love you. Now, you might be going, what a great godly girl. I'm drastically offended right now. I'm like, what? I'm just thinking to myself, why would you say it? Like, she goes, no, because, you know, if we broke up, I wouldn't be heartbroken because I love God more than I love you. I remember a couple of years later in our relationship, there's more to the story. There's no more to that story, guys. A couple of years later, this is what took place, right? I remember saying these words to Alyssa. I said, babe, if anything ever happened to you, I think I'd be okay. Like, as in, because I'd still have God. I'd still love God more than you, and I'd still have him in my life. Now, some of you are looking at me very strangely right now. And this is what you need to know. I love my girls a lot. Like, as in when it comes to Harley and Amara, she's kind of new, but I still love her. Like, as in, but here's the thing. Like, as in, I love Harley, Alyssa, and Amara. You ask anyone that knows me well, I am vicious. Like, I'm a vicious protector of my girls, okay? But I love God more than my girls. I love God more than my girls. And now some of you are wrestling with this right now, and in your head you're going, but my family is everything. You're thinking right now, but my daughters, my sons, my wife, my husband, they're everything to me. I want to tell you something. When you make God your everything, when you make God your omega, he is the end and your aim. Let me tell you something. You will become the best person that you need to be for the people around you. And I know some of you are going, oh, it's so uncomfortable. It's an uncomfortable thought, but you got to understand is that when you place Jesus as your alpha and omega, when he is your aim, not that relationship, young person, your finances are not your aim and your omega and end. Your career is not your end. But when you make Jesus your end, your omega, I want to tell you something. You will be the best person that you need to be for your family, for your friends, for your community. It is better to have Jesus as your everything, as your omega, rather than any other person or thing. When Jesus is your omega and end, I want to tell you something. Something just lifts, something just changes. This is what it says in Job chapter 1, verse 20. Because Job, he saw God as everything, and he lost everything. And this is what it says in Job chapter 1, verses 20 to 21. It says, at this. Do you know what at this means? At this is that he just lost all his houses. He had just lost all his income. His sons were dead. His daughters were dead. He had lost everything. And it says, at this, Job got up and tore his robe and shaved his head in distress. Then he fell to the ground in worship and said, naked I came from my mother's womb and naked I will depart. The Lord gave. He started my life. He is the Alpha, and the Lord has taken away. He is the Omega. May the name of the Lord be praised. I wonder if some of us could catch this spirit. I wonder if some of us could go, you know what, I love my family. I love what I'm going for. You have a beautiful car, but let me tell you, it's not your end. I love the interior. It's great. I wish I had one, but it's not your end. The house, the super, the retirement plan that you have, it is not your end. Jesus is your omega. He is your end. He is the Alpha and Omega. He is the first and the last. Job knew God is omega. He made him his aim. He made him all that he needed. If you have Jesus, you have enough. When you have Jesus, you have enough. Let's not be a church that puts people, position, and material as our end, but let's be a church that puts Jesus in our end, as our end. God is not a means to an end. He's the end. Don't just come to God for a miracle. Don't just come to God for a breakthrough. To the young person, don't just come to God for that relationship, but come to Jesus for Jesus. Let me tell you, Jesus doesn't say, serve me to get something. He says, serve me to get me. Yeah. That's what Jesus is saying. Don't serve me to kind of go, you're jumping through religious hoops. He's saying, hey, serve me because you love me and you get relationship with me. There is a great freedom when we realize that Jesus is our end. To refer to Jesus as Omega is to say that he is the last, that everything is orientated towards him. That all of history is leaning and going towards Jesus. That's what it's saying to say that he is Omega. Omega affirms that all creation finds its purpose and meaning in God. What God commenced in the beginning, Genesis 1:1, God will direct to its conclusion. Conclusion, what a great word, as I invite the worship team up and we're going to close here. Some would say that I should have finished with a little bit of history and thinking, but I want to finish here because I just think it's really important. But this is what I want to say is that I'll say what I said at the start. A name is just a name until you have some belief attached to it. A name is just a name until you have a revelation. Everyone say revelation. A revelation of it. Revelation chapter 1 verse 9, it says, I, John, the writer of Revelation, am your brother and your partner in suffering. You see, the suffering that John is alluding to is that the church has experienced a great persecution. He's writing this at the end of the first century. And this is what is taking place, right? The church is getting persecuted, and there's literally a systematic persecution taking place. Whether it's Emperor Nero or Domitian, whichever one you want to talk about, as in either way, it was systematic, and Christians were dying because of their faith. That means like you and I would be dead because of our faith. And I'm talking like it was chaotic deaths. People were being thrown to lions. They were having molten thrown on their heads. It was chaotic death. But this is what people know about Christianity during this time. During these great persecuting times, Christianity grew. The church multiplied. The more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied. This church was unstoppable. And when you hear this, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't really make sense that the church would grow through such persecution. But it's important to know, how did the church face such persecution? How did the church grow during these times? Well, you see, they had a revelation of Jesus. They had a revelation of Jesus, that he wasn't just a good teacher, leader, or healer, but they had a revelation of him, that he was Alpha and Omega. You see, witnesses would see the early church confront death with peace and joy and assurance. They would witness them. And this is the writing of Revelation. And this is what John is trying to say in this passage of scripture. He's saying, if you see Jesus as Alpha and Omega, you'll be able to face anything. If you see Jesus as your first and your last, you will be able to go through anything. If you see him as the beginning and the end, you'll be able to face anything. He is Alpha on your best days. I was thinking about like when I'm carrying our newborn Amara, sometimes Harley too, I'm thinking myself, this is such a beautiful day. And I think he is Alpha, he's the creator, he is the beginning, he is the first. It all started with him. When you're so happy about your relationship, and we're happy that you're happy, when you're celebrating your new job, et cetera, he is Alpha. He is the start. When you've started your new business, when you're so happy in retirement, whatever it may be, maybe your kids are doing so well, you're just loving life. He is your Alpha. Here's your beginning. It all starts with him. But you see, on your worst days, he's Omega. He is the end. You see, when Alyssa and I were having a miscarriage, he was the end. He was my aim. He's what I look to. Through that health condition that you're going through or a loved one is going through right now, he is Omega. He's your last. For the things that don't make sense, maybe you're stuck in depression. Maybe you've got a sense of anxiety. And even in this room, you're just kind of going, I can't do this. He is your Omega. He is your end. He is your last. He is Alpha and Omega. He is Alpha and Omega. Could I pray for a couple of people in this room this morning? We're going to have a time of worship, but before we do this, it would be my great opportunity to lead anyone that doesn't know Jesus into a relationship with Him. And here's the thing, like, we've been talking about Jesus as Alpha and Omega, and you're kind of going, no, I don't really believe that, like, as in, sorry, unbeliever here, happy about it, it's all good. Well, here's the thing, whether you like it or not, whether we all like it or not, He is Alpha and Omega. And Christianity is not escapism. It is the answer. Christianity is the answer. And whether you see Jesus as your end or not, here's what you need to know, is that He is your creator. He is your purpose. He is your everything. But He is also your judge. And the question will be at the end of your time is, will you know Him? Will you know Jesus? And will He know you? And in moments like this, we want to give opportunities for you to begin a relationship with Jesus. So could I ask every head to bow and every eye to close across this room? And today, maybe you've been searching, and maybe something in your spirit is saying, this is true. I must make Jesus my Lord and Savior. I must put Him at the start. He is my Alpha. Maybe you've been wrestling with God for the last few weeks or months or years, and you've never crossed that line for a relationship with Him. I want to tell you, today is the day that you can make this incredible decision to follow Him. He loves you so much that He gave everything for you. The creator of the universe, the Alpha of everything. He has no beginning. He is uncreated and He loves you so much. And so today, if you want to have a relationship with Jesus, if you want to begin this relationship with Him, would you just lift your hand so I know who I'm praying with? Just so I know, across this room, awesome, I see that hand. Anyone else across this room, awesome, I see that hand. Anyone else, yep, I see that hand. Yes, anyone else across this room, He is Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and He loves you so much. Anyone else? I'm just going to wait for a few more moments, and then we're going to pray together. Come on, anyone else in this room? Such courageous people putting up their hand today. You are Alpha and Omega. Come on, as one family, could we pray together? Thank you, Jesus, for accepting me. I believe that You died for my sin and that You're alive today. Today I choose to turn from my ways and follow You. I make You my aim and I choose to walk with You. Amen. Come on, can we put our hands together for everyone that made a decision?